One of you to our Eucharist this weekend as we celebrate the feast or the solemnity of the body and blood of Christ. For those of you who speak Latin, the feast of Corpus Christi. And welcome to those of you around our parish and those of you who are joining us from beyond our parish boundaries. We gather together as the people of God in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
And to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, we call to mind our sins and God's wonderful mercy. Lord Jesus, your body is broken open and shared for the life of our world. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your blood is poured out in a great act of sacrifice and surrender to your Father's will. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And Lord Jesus, as members of your body, our gifts are to be broken open and poured out for the life of our world. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who in this wonderful sacrament have left us a memorial of your passion, grant us, we pray, so to revere the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may always experience in ourselves the fruits of your redemption, who live and reign with God the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God for ever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Remember how the Lord your God led you for 40 years in the wilderness to humble you, to test you and know your inmost heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. He humbled you. He made you feel hunger. He fed you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to make you understand that man does not live on bread alone, but that man lives on everything that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Do not then forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who guided you through this vast and dreadful wilderness, a land of fiery serpents, scorpions, thirst, who in this waterless place brought you water from the hardest rock, who in this wilderness fed you with manna that your fathers had not known. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response is, praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Oh, praise the Lord, Jerusalem. Zion, praise your God. He has strengthened the bars of your gates. He has blessed the children within you.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He established peace on your borders. He feeds you with finest wheat. He sends out his word to the earth and swiftly runs his command.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He makes his word known to Jacob, to Israel his laws and decrees. He has not dealt thus with other nations. He has not taught them his decrees.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. The blessing cup that we bless is a communion with the blood of Christ, and the bread that we break is a communion with the body of Christ. The fact that there is only one loaf means that, though there are many of us, we form a single body because we all have a share in this one loaf. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Has come down from heaven. Anyone who eats this bread will live forever, and the bread that I shall give is my flesh for the life of the world. Then the Jews started arguing with one another, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus replied, I tell you most solemnly, if you do not eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you will not have life in you. Anyone who does eat my flesh and drink my blood has eternal life, and I shall raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood lives in me, and I live in him. As I, who am sent by the living Father, myself draw life from the Father, so whoever eats me will draw life from me. This is the bread come down from heaven, not like the bread our ancestors ate. They are dead, but anyone who eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Each one of us spends a great portion of our life waiting. Sometimes it's a very simple matter, like waiting at the checkout at the supermarket or waiting for the lights to turn green in the traffic. And sometimes we wait for the football season to start again, so a lot of us are happy that that's been happening in the last couple of weeks, the rugby league and the AFL. And sometimes our waiting has rather more significance. We might be waiting for the birth of a child, or for the passing of an exam, for a wedding, And sometimes we're waiting with someone as they prepare to die, as one of our wonderful families in the parish have been doing this week. And sometimes our waiting is a matter of our own choosing. We choose to wait, and we have some freedom in that. Often we are waiting when we have very little or no choice. And we've experienced that each of us through these last few months of the lockdown due to the COVID pandemic. It reminds us that there are people who are waiting, sometimes for a lifetime, for their basic human needs to be met. For food, for drink, for liberty, for justice, for a place to live. And that has come sharply into focus for us these past couple of weeks, or the past 2 or 3 weeks now, regarding the rights of black Americans to start with, and then it's spread around the world to our own country, where we've been focused on the rights of our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. And some of them are still waiting for justice in many respects. Our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, for instance, are not even mentioned in our constitution. They're still waiting for that to happen. Many of them are waiting for justice at the hands of the law, because the law that has governed their culture is so different from white fellow law. They have a great deal of trouble fitting into that, and so we have such a disproportionately high incarceration rate of Aboriginal people. It's certainly in some parts of Australia, in many jurisdictions of Australia. And so the injustice of that is being brought out in the demonstrations that we're hearing about and seeing around our nation at this time. We've had comments this week about slavery from our Prime Minister, who declared, and then he apologised later for his statement, that there'd never been slavery in Australia, and of course he was referring to our past. The ABC had a program the other night countermanding that, or contradicting that statement quite clearly. But there is slavery going on in Australia right now, of course, often in the form of human trafficking. And it has been, and still is, a part of our society. And there are people in that situation who are waiting to be fed and nourished with mercy and justice and dignity. This coming week is Refugee Week. And again, we're being reminded of that, and we can get a bit weary, I suppose, hearing constant talk about refugees and their needs, but their needs are still there, and many of them are being met, many of them are not being met. Thankfully, there are some success stories in Australia with regard to the treatment of refugee people. We hear stories of people who are now doctors or serving the society in many other ways. One wonderful Vietnamese refugee is currently the governor of South Australia. It's a wonderful story, his story, if you care to look it up. But there are still people in very desperate straits. A quick look at the website of the Jesuit Refugee Service, with whom our parish has an alliance, would tell you something of the trauma that people seeking refugee here have been going through during the COVID lockdown, and the distress that's been caused, and real distress that's been caused to them. So there are many people in our society, and I've just named three different areas there. There are many others that you could name for yourselves, of people who are still hungry and still thirsty for the bread of justice, for the bread that comforts, for the bread that nourishes. When we say our Amen to the excuse me, to the body and blood of Christ, we who are relatively well fed can be very, very thankful for the nourishment we receive. We can rejoice in the faith that we have in the beautiful gift of the sacrament of the Eucharist, where Jesus becomes truly present with us through the consecrated bread and wine, and through the mystery of our being part of his body, the body of Christ. Our Amen also means that we are committed to his mission, the mission of the good news, and that while many people are waiting, they need people to wait on them, and that we are being called to be waiters, if you like, and waitresses, to bring his good news to those parts of our world that are within our reach. So this feast is a really wonderful reminder of the beautiful gift of our faith and the challenging call that our faith gives us to mission. Having said that, I must say that in our parish, you, our parishioners, are absolutely wonderful in your generosity and in your response to any appeals that we have and any cries for need that we become aware of that we put before you. You're just amazing. So we can be truly thankful for that. And we can take this beautiful feast day as an opportunity to reflect again on our faith and our mission, and to recommit ourselves to both, to deepening our faith in the presence of Jesus within us and among us and through the Blessed Sacrament, and to our mission to be bread and wine poured out for the life of our world. So as you listen to this little hymn now and follow along, maybe sing along with the words, pray quietly and reflectively about how you might continue to grow as bearers of his good news, as nourishment, as food and drink. Remembering Jesus, who is our bread of life, means to nourish us and the whole of creation.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body and life everlasting. As people who wait gladly and with hope for the gift of the Eucharist, and as people who commit ourselves to the mission that the coming of the body and blood of Jesus within us and among us calls us to, we now bring our prayers before our Heavenly Father.
For the Church, our Holy Father, Pope Francis, and all our leaders, we pray. May our presence in the world become even more clearly a reminder of your saving purpose for all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May the broken bread of the Eucharist become the pattern for all of us as we break open our gifts in our families and parish community. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May the wine of the Eucharist, as it makes present the sacrifice of Jesus, call us to pour out our lives with compassion, courage, and generosity, so that our world might become more alive with God's saving love. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our Indigenous brothers and sisters, we pray. May the renewed call for justice and respect be heeded by those in government and by the whole community. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In this refugee week, we pray for all those displaced people who are seeking safety and dignity for themselves and their families. May we continue to listen and respond to their needs. For this, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those in public office, we pray. May they serve rather than rule. May they lead rather than work the system. May they love rather than fear for their own survival. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those among us who are unwell, who grieve the loss of loved ones, and who are struggling to give real meaning to their own life story, we ask for your peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the Sidgraves family, for the repose of the soul of Annette, who passed away this week, and for Brian, her husband, and for Donna and Richard Quinn, and the members of all that family who are grieving their loss at this time. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's pause, and you might like to add any of your own prayers quietly here or at home. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Thank you.
Sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. Grant your church, O Lord, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace, whose signs are to be seen in mystery in the offerings we here present, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For at the Last Supper with his apostles, establishing for the ages to come the saving memorial of the cross, he offered himself to you as the unblemished Lamb, the acceptable gift of perfect praise, nourishing your faithful by this sacred mystery. You make them holy so that the human race, bounded by one world, may be enlightened by one faith and united by one bond of charity. And so we approach the table of this wondrous sacrament so that, bathed in the sweetness of your grace, we may pass over to the heavenly realms here foreshadowed. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we, with all the host of angels, cry out, as without end we acclaim. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." We offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Anthony our Bishop, all the clergy and all those who minister your gospel. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
At the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await with the blessed hope and coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And
we offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Thank you all for our sharing in our Eucharist tonight on this feast of Corpus Christi. To our little team here, for our readers, Kira and David, thank you especially for being with us. As many of you know now, our churches are starting to open up and we have all our regular weekend masses available now, except there's a limit, of, as you know, of 50 people per mass. And if you wish to come to one of those masses, you need to book in. And as you would have seen in our bulletin, we have a try booking. You can book online or simply ring our parish office and Catherine will book you in. And for our weekday masses from now on, you won't need to book in, but you will still need to provide your name and your details for tracing purposes when you come to morning mass during the week. We hope the numbers will increase and be able to increase, say, in the coming month or so, and as we get through this interim period. So as we do that, we need a lot of patience and we need to cooperate with the regulations that are placed upon us for everyone's safety's sake. So a special thank you to everyone for that. Some elements of our parish are coming to life again. We're starting to look at some face-to-face meetings as well as Zoom meetings for some of our parish groups. So they'll be noted in the parish bulletin over the coming weeks. And bit by bit, we'll come back to life as best we can. So let's pray our parish prayer. Loving God, you are the home for our heart's deepest longings. We find our way as families and as individuals only in you, through our brother Jesus, encouraged by the breath of your Spirit. We thank you for all the blessings we enjoy in our parish family. May we continue to share our gifts of life and love with glad and generous hearts. May our world be somehow more alive because we have passed this way. May Mary, our parish patron, continue to inspire us as we give new birth to your word in our turn. We make our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that we may delight for all eternity in that share of your divine life which is foreshadowed in the present age by the reception of your precious body and blood, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And
may Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go in the peace of Christ.
Amen.